Thank you, Jack. It is most certainly a blessing to see you all tonight. And what I would like to talk about this evening is why I have made the decision not to drink alcohol and why I think everybody else should make that same decision. And the reason I've titled it that, the reason I'm stating that very carefully, I think will become clear as we go through the lesson tonight. As Brother Jack just read, Galatians 5 and verses 19 through 21 condemns drunkenness. And as he brought out so capably in his reading, the end part is the really important part, that this is, first of all, not an all-inclusive list. It's not an exhaustive list. There are other things that Paul could have put on this list also. But he ends by saying, do not be deceived. Those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And I believe that we're all comfortable saying that, that drunkenness is a sin that will keep a person from the eternal inheritance, from that fellowship with God forevermore. But sometimes, and sometimes actually even members of the body of Christ, will point out and say, well, wait, what about just a little bit of drinking? What about not drinking to the point of drunkenness? Is that really condemned in Scripture? And I think that you will see by the end of this that it is, and that it is something that if we're going to make a mature decision, we want to just make a blanket statement to stay away from altogether. But let's get to that. Remember that the Bible is an eternal document. It is a book, it is a message that is written to people from many different cultures in many different periods of time, many different ages. And that original context, those original people to whom the Bible was written, did not possess things like refrigeration or pasteurization. And it's just simply a matter of science that once grapes are squeezed, the juice very quickly and very naturally begins to ferment, which, by the way, is the point of the parable in Matthew 9 and verse 17, the wineskin that burst because new wine was poured within, and then it begins to ferment. Naturally, it continues to ferment until it reaches approximately 5% alcohol. It actually takes months and months of fermentation, which gradually begins to slow down if allowed to take its natural course, until it reaches a maximum of about 14%. And what happens after that is that the alcohol begins to be converted into acetic acid and the wine becomes vinegar. And we know that this was considered to be disgusting and it was often reserved to do nothing more with than serve to criminals. In Matthew 27 and verse 48, that is what is there at the foot of the cross for those condemned men. Historians tell us that in most cases, fermented wine would be mixed with water, perhaps to kill the living things within in order to make those things safer to drink. But even if a person were to drink this ancient wine straight up, it would take hours upon hours of pretty devoted drinking to exceed your liver's capacity to metabolize alcohol and to truly become drunk. One really had to do it all day long with that set purpose in mind. And so, for example, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 15, this is why when the Jews accused Peter and the apostles of being drunk, his response to them was, these men are not drunk, it is only the third hour of the day. It was almost an impossibility to imagine that they had successfully become drunk because those alcoholic beverages, generally speaking, just weren't all that powerful. And there are examples throughout Scripture where wine is used in very positive settings with very positive connotations. Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 13 is one such example, where it says that God will love you and bless you and multiply you. He will bless the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground, your grain and your new wine and your oil, the increase of your herd, the young of your flock, the land which he swore to your fathers to give you. That's obviously very, very positive. And there are many other such passages throughout the Bible that describe wine as a blessing. Now, one of the interesting things that scholars will sometimes point out, and I think that this is very interesting, and I'm not sure that I've ever been able to really prove this, although I have read a number of scholars who take this position, that there is something special about the adjective new there. That the word wine is a very broad term all by itself. It'd be kind of like our English word milk. that it could mean lots of different things under the umbrella of milk. You might mean 1%. That's not really milk, by the way, between you and me, but just saying, you might mean 1% low fat or skim milk. That's just white water is all that is. Or you might mean whole milk, or you might mean buttermilk, or you might mean all kinds of different things that fit under the heading of milk. And many have suggested that the Hebrew or the Greek word wine is a very broad term under which many things might be included, and that we have to use the context to determine which of those things is meant. And according to this argument, the idea of new wine is of wine or juice that is freshly squeezed, that hasn't yet really had the opportunity to begin going very far down that pathway of fermentation. Isaiah 65 and verse 8 actually talks about wine as a word used to describe juice that's still in the grape, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one says, "Do not destroy it, for there is benefit in it, so I will act on behalf of my servants." So perhaps there is something to that reading, and if so, it really helps me to understand John chapter 2, where indeed Jesus performs his very first miracle at a celebration, at a wedding. And you'll notice that he, you know the story, he turns, I think it's 165 gallons of water into wine. And when the head waiter tasted the water which had become wine and did not know where it had come from, the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called to the bridegroom and said, "Every man serves the good wine first. And when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." Now, most of the time that I had always read this, I had assumed like the really sophisticated wine was served first, the one with the really nice vintage and the really beautiful bottles. It's possible, if these scholars are correct, that what's really going on here is that the head waiter is saying, "You've reserved the freshest wine," and that's strange, that the new wine, the fresh wine, would be the most prized, and those farther along the process of fermentation would actually be less so. I think that's an interesting point, and one that, again, I have to continue researching and studying, but I think there's something interesting to that. But whether or not you accept that, I think it is pretty clear that in certain cultures and certain times, without refrigeration, drinking without intoxication, I'm not going to say it would be acceptable to God. I think it would be basically unavoidable. And if you took our society and if you bombed us back to the Stone Age so that we didn't have refrigeration and we didn't have Publix and we didn't have all of these things, then I would happily reconsider my stand on avoiding alcohol altogether. But we don't face that same situation when we're standing in the aisle of Publix today. We have many, many other choices available to us. And it's just silly to use ancient wines to justify modern drinking practices. As I mentioned to you before, natural fermentation rarely exceeds 5%, and really, scientifically, almost can't go past 10 or 14%. The process, however, of distillation was invented by a monk in the 12, 13, or 1400s in order to concentrate alcohol. And so today's alcoholic beverages allow you to get legally drunk, sometimes on just one drink, but certainly on not very many at all. So that is why it is just totally ridiculous to try to justify modern drinking with passages that we read in the scripture about a situation that really was just very different. Modern life provides lots and lots of alternatives to alcohol. We don't need to treat our water with alcohol to kill the germs. We can buy whatever we want to in the grocery store. We can purchase bottled water, juice, milk, tea, Coke, whatever you want. Thanks to refrigeration and transportation, the opportunities are absolutely endless. And so as a result, alcohol has become associated with a choice and with certain lifestyle choices. If you want proof of that, watch any beer or wine commercial. And you will see that the culture of drinking includes a whole lot of other things that go along with it. And so one of the questions that we have to ask ourselves is whether or not we really want to support that culture, of what kind of image we would really want to portray. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verses 19 through 23, I think if I remember correctly that Brother Doug brought up this passage in our class this morning, 1 Corinthians 9, verses 19 through 23, where Paul says, "Though I am free from all men, I have made myself a slave to all so that I might win more. To the Jews I became a Jew so that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law as under the law, though not myself being under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. In those who are without law as without law, though not being without the law of God, but under the law of Christ, so that I might win those who are without law. To the weak I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. I do all things for the sake of the gospel, so that I might become a fellow partaker with it." I think that last part is the key there, that if it could make the difference between my ability to speak to somebody about the gospel, whether or not I have a drink in my hand, then I'm going to think very carefully about that image and about the impression that I might leave with someone else. And it's not just our influence to the world around us, but it's also our influence upon our brothers and sisters in Christ. In Romans 14, verses 14 through 21, Paul here has a lengthy discussion of being very careful about our choices with respect to our brethren. "I know and am convinced," he says, "in the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean in itself. But to him who thinks anything is unclean, to him it is unclean. If, because of food, your brother is hurt, you are no longer walking according to love. Do not destroy with your food him for whom Christ died. Do not let what is for you a good thing be spoken of as evil, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who in this way serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another. Do not tear down the work of God for the sake of food. All things indeed are clean, but they're evil for the man who eats and gives offense. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or to do anything by which your brother stumbles." So I think one of the considerations that we need to include in our thought process when we decide whether or not to partake of alcohol is, what is it going to do to my brothers and sisters? What's it going to do to my influence in the church? Is it going to create an issue? Is it going to cause my brother or sister to stumble? And I would think that in this congregation and in this community, drinking would at least raise some eyebrows and some red flags to people that we may meet in the community and people here among our church body. So add that consideration to our list. But I think also the environment and the associations that goes along with drinking would pretty carefully steer us in a different direction as well. I said at the beginning that the Bible focuses on drunkenness and very clearly sets that aside as something that we as Christians want to avoid because it can ruin our fellowship with God. But you know what else? The Bible actually does condemn social drinking in a lot of other contexts too, even without the necessary connotation of drunkenness. The passage that we looked at the first time that Jack read for us, I didn't get Galatians into the slideshow. I'm so very sorry. So Galatians 5, verses 19 through 21 warns us to avoid carousing. You'll notice the word right after the word drunkenness is the word carousing. And if you look this up, this is a Greek word, komos, that is mostly translated reveling. Vine's dictionary says it's the kind of party where alcohol is present. And indeed, it also appears here, the passage on screen in Romans 13, verses 13 through 14. I have heard it defined as intoxicated merrymaking. So the whole idea, I just went to the bar. I just didn't have anything to drink. I went to the party. I just didn't participate to the point of drunkenness like everybody around me. As you can see, is not really an excuse that we would want to make. Carousing itself is something that is associated with that environment that God tells us to set aside and to avoid. And then here's one other in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 3. Peter says, "The time already past is sufficient for you to have carried out the desire of the Gentiles, having pursued a course of sensuality, lusts, drunkenness, carousing, there's that word again, and here's another one, drinking parties and abominable idolatries. That word, drinking parties, is a very simple Greek term, potos. We get our English word potable water from it. And it just means drinking, but obviously in this context, it's a certain kind of drinking, right? But it's the idea that it doesn't matter how plastered somebody becomes. It's just the involvement in the atmosphere of a drinking party that God wants his children to avoid. Even if, oh, I was just having a couple of wine coolers and I really didn't get all that drunk. Those are not excuses that we want to make. God's word actually steers us in quite the opposite direction. And inevitably, when we're having a conversation about whether or not a Christian should participate in drinking, yes, 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 23 comes up. And it's often used to say, well, look, Paul said it was okay for Timothy to take a little wine, you know, it's not that big of a deal. I would suggest that the way this is often used is exactly backwards. The real point is that what Paul said to Timothy is, no longer drink water exclusively, use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments, that Timothy was being so cautious about his image that he was avoiding alcohol even though it could have obviously helped him. And so Paul's saying, Timothy, really, no, it's okay. You need this for medicine. You need this to help your ailments. It's okay. Don't worry about the image. Go ahead and drink a little bit for your stomach's sake. And by the way, research has shown that the health benefit in a glass of red wine comes largely from a compound in the skin of the grape, and that it is equally obtained from grape juice without the added concern about the health damage from the alcohol. So you can still be healthy and get all those vitamins just from Welch's. Finally, it is very important that we need to beware the real concern behind all of this. And that is that alcohol so often, not in every case, but so often, and in cases that you and I can both think of, leads toward a situation that results in addiction, a situation that is very, very difficult to overcome from. The danger of becoming addicted and enslaved is really an ever-present concern. It's interesting that as you begin to scan through the scriptures, and if you start to think about all the different places where drinking is mentioned, and Bible characters who were participating in drinking, it's really hard to find something glorified and honorable and dignified and sophisticated about those various situations. In fact, the more and more you think about it, it's hard to find anything positive at all about the influence of alcohol in these people's lives that we meet in Scripture. So what I would like to do in order to help put this point across to our hearts very firmly is to just kind of page through a few things and look at six different examples of people who got drunk in the Scripture. Let's see what happened to them. So we'll start off with Noah, who, as we recall, was a very faithful man, saving his family from the flood. But sometime later, he planted a vineyard, he got drunk, and it says there in Genesis chapter 9 that he uncovered himself in his tent before passing out. And when Noah's son Ham entered, he saw the nakedness of his father and was cursed forever. Now, I don't understand everything that's going on in that passage. There's a lot of unanswered questions that I still have about that whole thing and why it is that Ham was cursed. But I'll tell you this. There are plenty of other obvious ways that children of today are brought to catastrophe by the depraved, drunken condition of their parents. And Noah found himself in a situation that he otherwise never would have gotten himself involved in if it weren't for the fact that he got himself passing out drunk. And so remember Proverbs 23 and verses 33 and 34, which says that if you get drunk, your eyes will see strange things, your mind will utter perverse things, and you will be like one who lies down in the middle of the sea, or one who lies down on the top of a mast. Now that image there, I don't know if you've ever been on a sailboat or not, or just any kind of boat, it doesn't make any difference. And you know when the seas get to go in just a little bit, even though you're on the deck, it kind of, if you're a person who gets a little bit of seasickness, it can be really difficult to get through that situation, and you kind of have nausea, you get a headache, you want to throw up, oh, you just want to get back on dry land. But that's on the deck of the ship. If you go up on the mast to the top, the crow's nest, and if you think the motion at the water level is bad, try the motion way up there at the top, where even a slight wave can make that mast go way back and forth. That's the image of one lying down on the top of a mast. His whole world is going crazy. Is that the way you want to feel? Well, that's the way you feel when you decide to begin drinking alcohol and you end up finding yourself drunk. The second example is also in Genesis. It's Genesis 19 and verses 30 through 38 where we encounter Lot. Lot, again, is called a righteous man in 2 Peter 2 and verse 7. But after his family escaped the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, after his wife was turned to that pillar of salt, he was alone with his daughters. And his daughters were very worldly women. They thought that their world was coming apart, and so they decided to commit incest with their father. Now, that is something that a sane, sober person would, of course, never, ever do. It wouldn't enter his mind. And so in order to make this plan work, they said, "Let us make our father drink wine, and let us lie with him." And when they had gotten drunk, they carried out that deed, and then resulting children occurred. That should tell us something. That's what alcohol does. It strips away inhibitions, even the most righteous person's inhibitions. It deprives us of our good moral senses. I guarantee you, the righteous man Lot would have never done such a thing sober. And so there's obviously a big warning for us in that passage. Our third example is of Amnon in 2 Samuel chapter 13. And verses 23 through 39. Now what's going on there is that David's son, Absalom, he desired to kill his half-brother for an earlier crime that Amnon had committed. And he was really patient, Absalom was. He waited 2 years before he finally had a good opportunity to get even with his half-brother. And what it says is that when Amnon's heart was merry with wine, that's when Absalom struck. Obviously, so that Amnon could not defend himself from the attack of Absalom. Now, I'm going to stretch this context a little bit and just remind us of what happens when a person's physical response time and reflexes are dulled under the influence of alcohol. Alcohol deprives drivers of reaction time, deprives pedestrians of awareness of their surroundings, deprives partiers of their good sense of their surroundings. According to statistics that I found in the USA Today, there is a National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism that reports that over 100,000 deaths a year involve alcohol. That is, there's some factor of that death that included drunkenness, 100,000 deaths a year involving alcohol. And that includes about 20,000 a year from diseases such as cirrhosis of the liver, but about 50,000 of those are from accidents. And if you were to look through various fatalities, alcohol is a factor in 83% of deaths due to fire, 72% of aggravated assaults, 70% of sexual abuse cases, 69% of drownings, 60% of deaths and injuries due to falls, 54% of all violent crimes, 50% of murders, 50% of fatal car accidents, 50% of spousal abuse, and 40% of child abuse deaths have alcohol as an aggravating factor. That's a lot. And so that would suggest that the dangers associated with alcohol far exceed any possible benefit to be gained from the nutrient in the skin of the grape. Here's our fourth, in Proverbs 23:35, they struck me, but I did not become ill. They beat me, but I did not know it. When shall I awake? I will seek another drink. Which, by the way, is one of the saddest commentaries in Proverbs about that situation. To experience all of that nausea and illness and headache and hangover, and to be struck and beaten and to wake up in the gutter one morning, and the first thought in that individual's mind is, I need to get another drink. That's that addictive nature involved in alcohol. It's just, if you never want to find yourself in that situation, don't get started. And then here's another example of the king who is deprived of his respect for others in Esther chapter 1. In Proverbs 31, verses 4 through 5, the wonderful advice given to King Lemuel is, it is not for kings to drink wine or for rulers to desire strong drink, for they will drink and forget what is decreed and pervert the rights of all of the afflicted. And that's certainly a good description of what happens here in the book of Esther, where King Ahasuerus had this 7-day banquet where drinks were served in golden vessels. The royal wine was plentiful. And it says on the last day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, that he attempted to parade his wife's beauty before all the people, and she refused his order, and he revoked her title as queen. And so the influence of alcohol can cause people to have no respect for others, to vandalize, to speak rash insults, even to become violent and demeaning. And then, sadly, the aftermath of such situations can be difficult to undo, even when sobriety finally returns. And here's a fifth. King Belshazzar, who was deprived of his reverence for God, can deprive us of our respect for other people, but it can take away our reverence for God. In Daniel 5, Belshazzar had this great feast for 1,000 of his nobles, and when Belshazzar tasted the wine, you see, that's always there. He tasted the wine. He ordered the holy items captured from God's temple to be brought in so that he and his fellow revelers could be drinking from these holy vessels. And it is at that moment that the hand of God wrote words of judgment upon the wall. And it was that very same night, according to chapter 5 and verse 30, that Belshazzar was slain. Realize that spirits and spirituality do not mix, and that one who is involved in drunken behavior very, very rarely has concern for the things of God. And to mix those two things together are going to create big problems. Don't forget Nadab and Abihu, who we always kind of focus on their choice to present to the Lord strange fire. If you dig deeply enough into Leviticus chapter 10, Moses says something about priests drinking and says that should never happen. And it leads one to wonder if alcohol was not involved in that situation as well. And again in Isaiah 5 verses 11 and 12, again in Isaiah 28 verses 7 through 8, it is very important that we don't mix spirits with spirituality. Instead, what Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18 says, do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord. It's just the right path to choose. And then finally, the real final part. Here's our sixth example. It's a servant who we find in Luke chapter 12 and verses 45 through 47. The master in this parable had some slaves who obeyed him conscientiously, but he had one slave who began to beat the slaves, both men and women, to eat and drink and get drunk. And it says that the master soon returned, found him in that drunken condition, in his stewardship, untended and unprofitable. And so the master very quickly cast him out. It is so sad to report, as you probably well know, that there are too many husbands who deprive their families by spending all of their paychecks at the bar on Friday night. Some who will go so low as to abandon all of the responsibilities of life, a job, a family, a home, just to escape into that haze of drunkenness. And that affects so many people. Again, I realize that not every drink is going to lead inexorably to one of these dramatically awful problems. But the fact is that it always starts somewhere. And for all of these reasons that I have presented, it is just the best option for us as Christians to avoid it altogether. And so as Solomon says in Proverbs 23, verses 29 through 32, who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who linger long over wine, those who go to taste mixed wine. Do not look on the wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. At the last, it bites like a serpent and stings like a viper. The only attitude that I can defend in this day and age for us as Christians is just simply to avoid it altogether. It's truly not only the safe path, but it's the path that has the best opportunity to influence people around us for good. Thank you so much for your attention here tonight. If you have any other questions about any of these things or you want the slides, I would certainly be happy to share them with you. Brother Brent has number 347 up as our invitation song, Who Will Follow Jesus? And again, sometimes the choice to follow Jesus takes us down paths that maybe we didn't at first expect. But indeed, if we will follow him, he will lead us to the gate that leads to eternal life, and we will be saved eternally. If we can help you tonight to begin that path, to confess your faith in Jesus and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, won't you come as we stand and sing this invitation song?